Excellent. Nice to be able to speak to you at last.
Yeah. Yeah. So how is it across the pond?
Yeah, excellent. Excellent life, excellent Helix.
So, how long have you had your Helix?
3 months, since January.
Okay. Yeah, it's about 3 months behind me.
Yeah, they didn't start shipping. We could pre-order, but we couldn't get the units until after Christmas.
So how long have you been part of the group?
Since before I got the unit.
Yeah. It's nine months old right now.
Sorry?
The group is 9 months old right now.
Yeah, I joined a few weeks earlier doing what I see a lot of the new users doing, which is sort of asking a few questions. Is this okay? And
yeah.
Really as good as the hype.
And it is, isn't it?
Yeah.
What's your most surprise? You know, obviously you tell yourself that the Helix is, you know, really, really good, but then you get it and you go, oh my, this is so much better than I expected.
Yeah, I think the biggest surprise was taking it out of the box and the size and the weight of it, first of all.
Yeah.
Because I'd come from just traditional pedals and a box ME5, really old first version of a multi-effects.
Yeah.
And which was light and featherweight, and then this thing came and the box was this huge.
Yeah.
You take it out, and it didn't get any smaller. You know, it's a monster.
Yeah, and you know, it's sturdy and well built. And I know there's been a few maybe hardware issues that they've had, but all in all, I haven't had any issues with mine.
No, touch wood, me neither. And you know, I mean, it's sad if you do get one, but in an early unit, it's amazing how few problems I think there are.
Right.
You know, the fact that you've got a few squeaky pedals here and there is.
Yeah, and to me, the squeaky pedal is just a matter of maybe even just loosening it a little bit. The only reason people get a squeak is a squeak is caused by grabbing and releasing and grabbing and releasing. So the fix is possibly getting some, maybe a little silicone in there, but is just loosen it a little bit so it doesn't grab so tight.
Yeah. I mean, mine's not had that problem, so.
No, me either. Yeah, it moves freely.
Big learning curve as well, though.
Yeah, but you know what? Like, in comparison to some of the other units that are out there, like the 500, there's a big learning curve there, and it's not as easy to learn.
No, I don't. I'm not from. I've seen the sort of. I've got a mate that's got a HD 500, but I've never, as I say, I've come straight from the old Boss ME5 type of stuff.
Right.
So it's a massive change for me, but it's also I've got back into trying to build a home studio with all the complexity of Cubase 8.5 and all that sort of thing. So everything is just new and
yeah. Got knocked. I like the routing and everything. It's just easy to route. And what are you using to monitor it?
I use JBL 308s. And the 310 subwoofer.
Right.
And then I've got a Fender 75 valve amp.
Yeah.
And it sounds great through both, but particularly through the studio monitors, it's fabulous.
Yeah. Well, I really like how easy it is to set up, and I'm using the Firehawk 1500 amplifier with it, and it's really that's quite a piece as well. So with your
postings, with the with going into that and the volume and stuff you can get from it,
right? And it's loud. I mean, it, until you experience it, you're like, wow. And I've used some PAs, and the louder they get, sometimes some of them can distort a little bit, just a little bit.
Yeah.
This thing loud is, there's no distortion. It's just downright amazing.
I mean, are you playing on stage at all, Chad?
Sometimes I go to jams, but I play with some friends, and we're going to do something, I think, in August up here in Vancouver at a little festival. So that'll be fun.
Because I used to gig years ago, but these days it's just strictly home studio stuff.
Right. That's the general use for mine is in the home studio. I've had, let's see. See you next time. Okay. Let's see. How do I connect? I have the app. Click the link. Okay. Hold on. Click the link. Okay, yeah. So so we'll be doing some live stuff in summer. We got one song down. We're still working on it, but one in the can. We're going to try and have five.
Right.
Yeah.
But how many of you in the band?
Well, let's see. There's the drummer. And there's the keyboard player. There's two guitarists, me and another, and bass player, and a singer. So,
okay.
Yeah. So the drummer and the singer is father and daughter, friends of ours. And the guitarist is a close friend of mine. He's the guitarist. The other guitarist is the one who made this for me from scratch.
That's a beauty.
Yeah. And it's
flame maple top. What's the top?
Oh yeah, yeah. It's a kind of almost a tiger stripe flame.
Yeah.
And it's thick. It's got quite a carve. You can see the carve to it.
Yeah.
So it's a big carve.
That was custom made for you by a friend.
Yeah, yeah, and it's chambered, and this wood, the mahogany on it's really, really dense, heavy, hard wood. It's been chambered on the inside, and it still weighs 11 pounds.
Right. Because I've got one of the Gibson standard Les Pauls with the it's blue with like a watery pattern on the top.
Yeah.
And it's about 11 pounds weight.
Right.
So what was yours coming at in terms of weight?
11 pounds in weight. And this really thick baseball bat neck. I mean, it's weighty. And then I've got Spurzels on there.
Yeah.
And then here's my nod to Slash. It's got the Slash Alnico Seymour Duncan pickups in it. So, and then now this doesn't affect the tone, and I'd be crazy to tell anybody it does. I just like the feeling of quality. These pickup rings right there are metal. They're not plastic.
Right.
Yeah, so I mean, it's just everything on here feels just solid.
And the mirrored pick guard.
Yeah. A little flare.
It looks beautiful.
Yeah, it is. The lacquer he used, it checked, but he put it on. The lacquer he was using, I think, had a flaw. So you can see it's really chipping right in here.
Yeah, underneath the strings particularly.
Yeah. So it's fine. Works hey, good.
You know, to have a mate that makes guitars beautiful as that, it's unusual.
Yeah, and it's good. I actually somebody wanted to buy it at the last broadcast. Somebody said, hey, you know, something about nice broadcast. Hey, are you selling that guitar? So, like, no.
Hey.
Michael, how's it going?
What's up? Good to see you again.
Yeah. Hi, Mike.
I'll turn me down here.
So, how's it going, Michael?
It's going good. Call me Mike. Only my mother gets to call me Michael.
Oh, okay. It's just I'm reading it on the screen. It comes up as Michael.
I know. Well, my mom's a Jewish mom, so I can't argue with her.
I'll take
chicken that. Soup at me and matzo balls.
Right.
But I do eat ham. I do eat ham.
Yeah, I am a ham.
Yeah. Hey, I got the thing working a little bit today. That thing sounds, oh my gosh, it's just some of the sounds I'm getting out of that thing with my Les Paul and my Marshall is just amazing.
Yeah. You're liking it?
So far, I'm just wondering if I'm not getting the full range of sounds. Because the way I have it hooked up, I have it coming out of the quarter inch going into the send or something, or the return on the back.
That should be full range, but it's going into a Marshall cab speaker, right?
Yeah, 412.
And so the issue is, you're only going to get the frequency range that those speakers put out. Let's just say those speakers put out. From 80 hertz, yeah. on the low side to about 6,000.
So I think they're either vintage 30s or they're the what are those other ones, G12s?
Yeah, so you're in the range of about 100 to 6,000, right? But the Helix effects can all go up into higher range to the full range speakers. That's why I use the Firehawk. Is because the speakers in there are designed to be flat response, full range speakers. And so they're going to pull out all the frequencies. So what I end up doing is, and let me take you where this is kind of a...
Who's this other guy? I didn't see him. Hi, other guy.
Hi, Mike. I'm Gary from England.
Hey, mate. Little metal bottle, eh?
So if I go in and... share something. I'll share this screen here. Present to everyone.
Okay.
So one important thing to do is, well, it's not important at all costs, but if you want to mimic, so say you're using a full range speaker system to amplify.
Okay. What about my like JBL speakers hooked up to my Pro Tools?
Exactly. So you use those, right? Okay. So you use those. But what you'll want to do is because it's going to get everything these speakers, so you'll want to come and actually cut the highs.
Okay.
Down. Let's see. Hang on.
So I can use a low pass and a high pass filter.
No. This is on the speaker cab itself. So if you use a low pass or high pass, then what you're doing is you're cutting all the frequencies at that
point. I got you.
So what this is doing is this is actually you go in here and you mimic the guitar speaker's response. Right, and so you're actually in the cab and you're changing the guitar speaker's response so that the guitar speaker cab simulation is only sending out what a normal guitar speaker would, and then your effects can go higher or lower to a full range speaker. So going straight into a guitar, it's going to sound pretty good, like a Marshall or whatever. But you are missing out on some of the crystal highs from the effects and stuff.
Yeah. Are you able to do a screen movie of what you're showing me right here?
Or are you able to see what I'm doing?
Yeah, I'm on my iPad though.
Yeah, it's not really a movie, but okay. But I could show you another time. But it's really just putting the low cut of the speaker to about 100 to 120.
No, you're talking about in the software, in the edit, not on my speaker, not on my.
No. On the actual cab of in the Helix.
You can do it in the Helix itself, though, Mike.
Yeah, you can do it in the Helix itself or in the editor window.
What Dad's done is he's highlighted the cab that's in white at the top of the screen.
Yeah.
You can do the same on your Helix screen.
Okay.
And then you'll have the controls at the bottom, but in numbers rather than as a visual graph.
Yeah. Hey, Raspberry.
Hey.
Can
you guys hear me?
Sorry,
I'm out walking with my phone. I'll have to see if I can mute my microphone.
What was that? I just want to listen in. Break like the wind.
So, Raspberry, what's your name in the Facebook group?
Ken.
So I'm going to go ahead.
NASA, we have a problem. Houston, we have a problem.
There we go. I muted him so that he can join in when he's done walking.
And my wife's over here telling me to get muted so I can shut up, but that's okay.
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry. I don't get out much. I don't mingle with humanity too much.
Yeah, this Helix it causes you to mingle, doesn't it?
Oh my gosh, yeah. I just got it last night, and I went to bed at 9 o'clock because I wasn't feeling good, and I wasn't real determined to mess with it until like this afternoon. And I've been downstairs for like an hour, just going through some of the patches, and some of those things are just hellacious. They're great, like the Streets with No Name. And what's the other one that I saw? It's Run Like Hell from Pink Floyd.
Oh yeah, that's
really good.
That's a good one.
I had to pull up the tab just to learn that so I can really hear what it sounds like.
Yeah, there was somebody in the forums that I forget who it was. They were basically saying when you make a patch that you want to learn the riff of the song so you can really dial it in. I think it was Ben. Ben, he made the Metallica. Hey, Sebastian.
Hey.
I'm gonna put my earbuds in here so I can. All right.
Where are you based, Michael? Missed that, didn't hear it. Where are you based?
Oh, in Lynchburg, Virginia. I was waiting for you to ask me where was I from. I was going to tell you my mom, but, you know.
So, Sebastian, you still here?
Yeah, I'm there, yes. I'm not using the camera because it sucks anyway. It's crappy laptop camera, and the image is so bad, so worthless.
Well, glad to have everybody. I think the group is starting to catch up, starting to catch on.
This is pretty cool.
Yeah, we haven't even officially started. It's supposed to start in about a minute.
Okay.
But we're good. I started it early. It's broadcasting, so.
So this is a pregame warm-up.
Yeah, it's a warm-up. It's the fireside chat.
Yeah, there you go. And so tell me about this Firehawk thing you were talking about.
Okay, so that's down here.
Oh, so it's almost like an amp.
It looks like a
Fender Hot Rod Deluxe almost.
Yeah, and it's got a tilt back in the back. And it's loud. It's crazy loud. It's
does it say 1500 watts?
Yeah, it's 1500 watts.
1500. Wow.
It's got six. So let me show you. Let me do this presentation here. So hold on.
So definitely not for an apartment.
No, no. Yeah. Actually, no. Listen. Actually,
if you want to get evicted, buy one of these.
Oh boy.
No, actually, Sebastian. The beautiful thing about it is it can be used at apartment level, and it still sounds really good.
Really?
Okay. Oh yeah.
I would like Line 6 to come up with a solution for people like me with that needs a low volume.
this would be it. This is from Line 6.
But that is expensive, right? It's
$1,000.
$1,000? Yeah. So, since I don't play in a band, I don't think I'll put that money on.
Chad, I'm going to get off of this. I'm gonna get back on my computer, so I'm just going to log off and log back in.
That's fine.
Wow. We'll have to come in nice speakers.
Yeah, so there's actually this speaker is actually two daylight. Hang on, so that's actually two speakers.
Okay.
And then there's the
horn.
The horn the horn right here, and then the 12 inch. So you've got the bass ports on it, and
is it stereo?
Yes, stereo.
Oh yeah. Okay. Nice.
Yeah. So you know, you've got, well, tilt it forward here. So you've got, it's upside down. Let's see, maybe if we can spin it around.
Okay, that's the
input. Yeah, so you've got the mains in, right? And then you've got a stereo effects loop.
I see there's a thing to put it, to tilt it, yeah?
Yeah, and there's a tilt back, yeah.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah, and you get your mains out. You got your phones. So if you absolutely need it quiet, but you want it loud in your ears, you can do that. It's got a MIDI control, and it's got the Variax port, also a pedal port, USB, and it's Bluetooth. So you can play your music through it. It's a tremendous device. I used it at our band practice the other day on its own. I didn't take the Helix because I just wanted it was just a practice. So,
But it's too bad they don't make one with less wattage for people like me. You know, it's way too much.
Well, they do. They have the amplify, but it doesn't do stereo.
There's no input. There's only a guitar input on it. Huh?
You're right.
No link with the Helix at all. So,
yeah. Right. Yeah.
Ah. Too bad. I hope they make someone soon. But
Chad, you were saying that you can turn it right down to usable volumes.
Yeah. So. I had a tone that I was playing with at band practice, and I sit next to it, and this tone was crazy. It was like awesome sounding, and we wanted to turn everybody down so we could learn something off the music. I could just turn it right down, and it's we can talk over the top of it. It still has the same tone.
Wow.
But, yeah, so obviously, it's not hitting you. It's quieter. Go ahead.
The 75 is 75 watts of valve. And you get down to number 2, and it's still too loud in a domestic setting. And right. Below 2, it goes off.
Yeah, exactly.
For one, even though it's on the dial, doesn't exist.
Yeah, and so what this actually doesn't. This volume on it, the master volume that's on here, does not affect any of the tones. It doesn't affect anything. It's just louder. And I'm here to tell you, it was so loud. The first day I got it, I wanted to hear it. So. I had my guitar plugged in, and I turned the volume, like, all the way up, and I was just covering it like this, and I just tapped it. My son in the other room felt it in his chest. Imagine what I felt being right in front of it. It was, and so I was like, I turned it down. That's too loud. But it was, that little sound I made was crystal clear. It was there's no distortion in it. Hold on. I'm going to mute. Go ahead and talk.
Sebastian, I saw you on the first video when it was recorded and Chad posted it live. Nice to actually speak to you.
Yeah. Nice speaking to you.
Where are you based?
I'm in, near Montreal in Quebec.
Okay.
So it's right now it's 7 p.m.
Yeah, it's 5 past midnight here in the UK.
Oh, yeah, in the UK. Wow. Okay, you're still up.
Yeah, well, I said to Chad, don't tell me that it's in 3 hours' time when he posted the link, and he said, unfortunately, yes. Oh. Work in the morning, unfortunately, so I may not be here for the whole duration.
All the way from the UK to here, wow, very very far. But still, we can have a clear chat, even if we're far.
Yeah, technology is wonderful these days.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's see. Hold on.
When I was around 16, I used to have an amp that was the PV Mace, tube amp, 160-watt RMS.
Yeah.
I couldn't even play at level 1 without disturbing the neighbors. It was way too loud for an apartment. I had to get rid of it eventually. Too bad. It was a great amp.
I mean, The amps in a domestic setting are awkward. I mean, I live in a massive big stone house, but you know, the rest of the family still live here, and if you try and crank the valve amps up, it's just ridiculous. So I use JBL 308s and 310 subwoofer.
Okay.
Which were great studio monitors.
I just found something in the Line 6 forum, or in the Line 6 our group, from Eric Klein. And if anybody has a Mac, I have a Mac. It's got the Helix Mac Driver 1.0 Public Beta Mac Driver. Now it does not change the application or the editor. It's just the driver that controls the USB, from what I understand. And it supports a sample rate up to 96 kilohertz. The driver has nothing to do with that. It says, especially on the mid 2012 Retina MacBook Pros. That application appears to be fixed and should be resolved with the next Helix application editor release. So they're making major movements with the Helix. They're always working on it. It's amazing.
Can you guys hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
I hope in the next big update they'll have some new features or amps maybe.
Well, yeah, I think the next firmware...
Harmonizer, a real harmonizer.
The next firmware, from what I understood, was supposed to have some more stuff, but we didn't get that extra stuff. We didn't get the editor.
So just the compatibility with the editor, yeah.
Yeah, well, yeah, but if you're going to release an editor, you want that compatibility. But I understood it to be maybe something a little more, so maybe they're making it really good and they're going to have a nice release soon. I don't know.
So do you guys think I should upgrade my firmware before I even get into this thing?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Do it as early as you can.
Like now.
Yeah.
Sebastian, where are you from? Let me guess. Are you from Russia?
I'm from Quebec. Yeah,
oh, okay. So
Canada, Quebec. Yeah.
Same thing. No, I'm just kidding.
I have my French accent over my English.
That's all right. Hey, as long as you listen to Rush, then you're okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Gary, you're from England.
Yes. Okay.
I'm originally from Philadelphia, but I live in Lynchburg, Virginia. So,
Nice setup you seem to have in the background there.
Yeah, this is my man cave, man. This is what I do all day.
Man cave, cool. I'm stuck in the living room and between the living room and the kitchen.
Oh.
Yeah, that's alive in an apartment. That's what it is.
So all I got to do is just plug this thing in the back. What about the little this thing that came with it?
In my book, it's kind of an unnecessary piece of device.
So I just say
my the USB.
A manual on a stick.
Yeah, it's a manual on a stick, and frankly, mine is actually still in my box. I didn't even take it out of there. I just left it in the box.
I do use it. I use it with I put all the downloaded patch. I put them on it. So if I have the backup of all my downloaded patches.
Oh, that's a nice idea.
So there's not a lot of room. It's 50 megabytes. It's very small. They didn't give us a big USB key, but still, you can still hold a lot of presets and maybe not the IRs because they take too much space, but at least the preset, yes.
Is there some way I should do this?
Update them, yeah.
Or just...
So what operating system do you have?
I have Mac El Capitan.
Okay, so...
El Capitan. Oops.
Yeah, so...
There he is.
This is Mac 10.9.5. Which one? I don't know which one is that.
I don't know, but if you go to the software site...
I already downloaded all the stuff. I just didn't know if there was a certain order you have to do it in.
No.
Yeah, I posted a list earlier on one of the posts on the group. Okay. Somebody else was asking the same question.
Yeah, you don't need to do anything but install the Helix application, the 1.1101.
Oh, I already did that. Yeah, I already did that the other day.
Okay, so you just turn it on, and then you close everything. You don't open the Helix app. You open the Line 6 updater.
The monkey thing?
No.
No, not monkey.
No, Line 6 updater, different than monkey.
All right, no, that's from the site. Sorry if I sound ignorant, I am.
No worries. No, everybody needs help.
I know you said the 1.4 download. Well, that's this thing here.
No, not 1.4, 1.11.1 or something. All
right, let me go. I'm trying to find the website. I'm confused.
Here, let me put a link to you in the chat window.
All
right. Actually, let me type it in your Facebook window here.
Okay. You guys are so helpful. I really appreciate it. My wife just sent me a little thing. It says, I never realized how funny I was until I started talking to myself.
So you got a little link there.
Yeah, okay.
And then and you click that link. You want to... In fact, I'll even walk you sort of through it on the screen. I'm going to switch
the Helix,
over.
And then the Helix and Mac OS X. Do I do beta?
Beta, yes. Click beta, yes.
What about the license manager? I don't need to use that.
No, nothing. Just the beta.
Okay. And what's the Line Monkey for thing again?
Nothing to do with the Helix.
All right, so Helix 1.11 beta release thing, right?
That's it. Just get download there. Yep.
It looks like they've come a long way as far as their stuff.
Yeah.
Because it's been like 10 years or so since I've used the Line 6 product. I used to have all the stuff. I used to have the lima bean and the floor thing and everything.
Hey, Brad. How's it going?
I'm good. How are you? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I'm trying to get my camera. Oh, it looks like my camera's working. Let's see. I moved my laptop, and I was trying to get it to a place where I could get the camera face this way. It's kind of off-axis, but oh well.
Hey, Chad, have you posted a link on the official Linksys forums for the chat tonight?
No, I didn't. You can go ahead and do that if you'd like.
I think we're allowed to do it, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, maybe we can attract some more people that are not aware that we exist.
Yeah, the same link.
I'm like Horton, here's the who. We are here.
I joined through the forums to this link. There was somebody posted a hookup to it. Let's see.
Is that a BT, a boss BT, a GT, whatever over there?
Who's that?
Oh.
What's his name?
It's a GT8.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a GTA.
They're great. I got the Roland GR55 thing.
Oh, yeah. It's who's not the Helix, so I can tell you that. It's hard to get the sounds that you want out of it just because of the nature of it's older technology. It just doesn't have the processing ability that the Helix does, of course.
Michael, did you say you got the GR55?
I do. I've got the thing on my my Les Paul. Yeah, I love it.
Okay, I've got the GR55 as well, but I bought the GC1 strap to plug into it.
Oh, yeah?
What about ghost notes? You guys get any ghost notes with theirs?
Yeah, you can do all that stuff with it. It tracks great.
It does, yeah. Absolutely. I've had no tracking problems at all.
Weird. I had tracking problems on my Strat.
But did you bolt a pickup onto it, or was it with the built-in pickup?
Bolted on.
Okay, because the GC1 has got the pickup built into the Strat by Fender and Roland.
Right. Well, and my Strat, in all fairness, my Strat, it's a custom built Strat as well, and it's got a bird's eye maple neck and a.
Oh wow.
And it's has zero neck relief, so it doesn't buzz when you play it. But I have a feeling the ghost notes that I was getting were because it's such low action that it couldn't help but buzz. You don't hear it when I play it normally. It's just I have a feeling that the GK pickup was picking up extra.
You have to go inside of it and set it up. It takes a while.
Yeah, I did. I had it all dialed in, and then it finally gave up on me. So
now, are you using this thing? Are you using the GK3?
Yeah, the GK3. Yeah, I had that one.
I'm selling this one. I have another one on my Les Paul. I'm selling this one.
Yeah, I got rid of it because I got the Helix. I still pretty much have everything I need.
Yeah. Oh, sure. Yeah, that's what we all say.
I never have everything I need.
Oh, my gosh. Has my wife heard that before? We all have gas. Big time gas.
I mean, honestly, I've kind of got everything where I like. And
sure you do.
I just posted the link in the Line 6 forums.
I love it.
Nobody believes me.
Right.
Well, because we're all
musicians too. You can't lie to us.
You might be able to lie to your wife, but you can't lie to your musician buddies.
we know where our art is.
For some reason, Line 6 won't let
me. We're living that lie too.
Have to go back and I don't know what this is. Okay, well I'll this website.
Well, if any of y'all ever stumble across anybody who's looking for custom-made guitars, I've got two I need to sell so I can get a Helix. So far, I haven't any bites on them, but they're not cheap instruments, though.
Who makes them?
These were custom-made by a gentleman down in Victoria named Bill Thornbrew. This guy was amazing. He would repair violins, cellos, anything.
Oh, wow.
And he built quite a few guitars. I think these two are number 16 and 17. But I saw the raw wood that he had in his shop before these were made. They were just boards.
Hmm.
And you ought to see them. They're beautiful.
What are they made out of?
Walnut and bird's eye maple.
Oh, wow.
They're beautiful. Beautiful instruments. Heavy as the Dickens, but beautiful. But and sustain like you just wouldn't believe. They have good sustain because of the hard wood.
Yeah.
I think I'm choking myself here.
Have you guys ever seen this an instrument like this? This is called a Zendrum. I don't know if you can see it.
Wow.
It's a
wow.
I had this custom. It's a controller. It's a drum machine, but you wear it like this and you hook up a guitar, like Superior Drummer, and use it as a drum machine. And you can assign each one of these pads a different drum or whatever. I use this because I can't play drums anymore, so I use this.
Who makes this?
Zendrum.
Zendrum.
.com. Syndrome.
Oh, yeah. Looks like a guitar.
I know. It's expensive.
Must be, yes. I haven't seen a lot of them.
The guy who is in Bella Fleck helped design this.
Is it made of wood or plastic?
Yeah, no, no. This is bird's eye maple. I mean, this is flame maple.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Well, it's nice. It's cool.
It's wow. Beautiful. Sometimes I just sit here and look at it. I'm like, wow. You know.
You like gadgets like me.
Yeah.
In fact, if you wanted to see those guitars, I posted them on the forums at one point some time ago. I don't know how far back they are now, but they're probably back there a ways.
Let me see.
Bird's Eye Maple looks beautiful. My carving is a tiger-striped type maple. It's really, really pretty.
Is it a carving or a Kiesel?
I have a carving. I bought it back in 1999.
Yeah, I got a carving base amp. I like their products.
Yeah. I've got two Carvin Quad X preamps I'm selling. Well, I've sold one. I've got the other one listed out there on eBay, but they are good products. I use a Carvin tube power amplifier, and I've got a little Carvin Nomad 112. Yeah. So I've pretty much got a whole Carvin shop here. But I like their products. They're good and rugged, solid instruments, and their instruments are so finely made. They're just I love my carbon guitar. I will eventually have another one, but the Helix has got to come first. I'm just drooling to get a Helix. I'm scheming and plotting, figuring out what banks I can rob and stuff like that. Yeah. I mean, what I need is everybody that joins the forum has to donate $1 to me, and I'll have enough to buy a Helix.
Hey, I'm Jewish. The check's in the mail, buddy.
All right. I'm going to look for it. I'll give you my address. DM me, and I'll give you my address. Or you can use PayPal.
Yeah, sure. I guess I got to make a new account with this because it's not taking any of my information. This is really weird.
You make sure you use your user ID and not your email address in the user.
Yeah, I've used that several times, but it's not taking any of it. It's weird.
Hey, Chad, how do we get the Line 6 shirts like what you got? How did you acquire that?
Yeah, well, nice person sent it to me.
Ah, huh. You have inside contacts, huh?
Yeah.
Nice.
It's nice. So.
Even if they would sell a T-shirt $20, I would buy it.
Yeah.
They don't have any.
They ought to give you a shirt when you buy the Helix. You paid for about 50 of them.
Yeah, of course.
Well, the Helix, it's worth every penny from what I see.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
I mean, I would have an Axifax. I think they sound great, but if you compare all the features and take away your ego and your choice, and you compare the features. Well, yes, you have more, in the Axe FX, you have, 20 of a certain kind of amp, similar little variants, but it may not be EQ, but I don't know. I've got enough amps with the Helix, but if you compare all the other features, all the other checkboxes, the routing, the USB ins and outs, the
capacitive buttons.
The capacitive buttons. There's just a bunch of game-changing stuff screen on here. At some point maybe we could have the scenes that everybody talks about, but so far with the 32 spaces to put stuff, I haven't needed any scenes yet, although I can see a benefit to it. In all the other things, then you look at the price.
And the great thing with the axe, though, is it does sound great, Chad. I mean, I like the sound of it.
Oh, I told, listen,
for me, the user interface was the game changer. Is the Helix is so easy without even looking at the manual to get into and just start doing stuff creatively. I mean, things like the boss, I had the 100, which looks a bit like the one that's on the side of the screenshot at the bottom there, but it's the user interface. You've got the double LCD and you're going down menu after menu, row after row after row, and it's just a pain in the neck.
I agree.
Whereas the Helix, you can twiddle around with a few knobs, you can drop blocks in, and you in 2 seconds you're playing, and that's got to be the main thing.
Right, I agree with you. I think the Axe Effect sounds amazing. I heard it live with Larry Mitchell, and
I know Larry. He's a good guy.
Yeah.
Does
it
sound better than the Helix?
There isn't a better.
It's different.
It's different. Let me give you what Cliff of Fractal said. He basically said that they took a road. Their road was to give you an optimized tone, right? And so it's not going to be an exact model of what is there. It's an exact model, but they optimize the EQ of the tones to give you that punch, that go. Well, here's the thing. This is what Cliff said. Line 6 chose a more faithful, warts and all. Of what the real amp is, and like I said, I think in the last week's broadcast, if I just take and grab one of those amps that they modeled and sit it in here and go plug it in, go, oh, I think it sounds bad, and I don't twist any knobs, I'm kind of being foolish, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's the issue. It doesn't sound better or worse. It sounds different because there was different modeling. Different modeling ideas when they decided to do it. Now, that being said, let me switch over and show you something. There is the global EQ, and doing it inside of the app, right here, you can go in and you can sculpt different things, right? And it totally changes the tone, and that's that sculpting that I believe that Fractal has done is and I think it was Henry that put me onto this kind of curve, this bounce like this, where you've got it about 500, you're getting that little bump that will give you that kind of cut in the middle, kind of creamy thing that the Axe Effect does. So Henry Switzer, his son has an Axe Effect too, and there was just something about it that Henry liked, and he says he was able to take and, hey Whip,
how you doing?
Good. How you doing? There was just something that he was able to capture with changing the global EQ like this. So,
and he was able to get the X sound that way.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he was able to get the sound that optimal Axe Effect kind of a tone. So, hey Christian, how you doing?
Yes.
So good. We looks like we're getting a full group. Let's see. We got room for a couple more. I think it tops out at 10. People can watch it, but when people drop in and out, they can join. But I think you have a 10 on here.
How many of you are playing bass through the Helix as well as guitar?
I have. Yes. I'm going to try it. I don't know how it sounds, but I'll try it. It's got SVT stuff in it, so it's got to sound good.
Not tried it yet?
No. I have a 6-string bass and a 4-string. I don't want to blow my amps up just yet.
I play a Fender Aerodyne through mine, and the bass models are awesome.
Are they really?
Yeah.
Yeah. I got a Fender Jazz, and I got this Ibanez.
I actually just traded my. I had a Variax bass, and I traded it in to get my 5-string Ibanez. I really like the Variax bass. It played great. It sounded great, but I needed a 5-string, so. I didn't have the funds because I bought a Helix. So.
Christian, you're the one that made an unboxing video of the Helix, I think, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, that before I bought mine, yeah, I saw your video. A nice video.
Thank you. It's funny when people like say they've seen my videos because like I've had a couple of times where I go to Guitar Center and actually like I had this I made a video about a couple of weeks where there's a guy that had his Helix and I was just at Guitar Center just putzing around on a Saturday. And I used to work there, so they all know I love Line 6 stuff. And they came up to me and they said, hey, there's a guy here with his Helix, and he can't get any good tones out of it. And I was like, what? And they're like, so you want to go help him? I'm like, sure. And so I like go back to the PA room where they have it all hooked up, and he's like, hey, I've seen your video on this. So it's just funny.
Yeah, you have no beard, I think. No.
Well, hey, Christian, I've been watching you for longer than the Helix, so...
Well, thank you. So it's a lot of fun. I make the videos for myself, so it's like fun when other people like them. But then people get annoyed because like I get all these comments all the time of like, you make a lot of Line 6 videos. It's like, well, I have fun doing it. Like I'm not paid to do it. Like I'm not having people like ship me stuff so that I can do their videos for them. It's just me, so it's fun.
Yeah, I can't stand the haters. The people who are doubting anything that you do, especially because, listen, if you look at, you have a lot more, I think, subscribers than I do, but if you just looked at what actually YouTube actually gives you per, it's a joke. I mean, so anybody who does videos, for the most part, unless you've got millions of subscribers, you're doing it because you like to.
Exactly. You guys keep talking. I have like 10% battery on my iPad, so I'm going to get my plug for it.
Sure, no problem. No problem. So Whip...
Okay, so saving the file now. So I got this upgrade. Okay, so once... I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt anybody.
So where are you at, Mike?
I'm right here at home.
No, I mean... No, in your upgrade process.
I know. I'm being a smart aleck. I'm sorry. I haven't been out today. It's downloaded. You got 13 seconds left.
Okay. Well, if you have trouble putting it in there, and then the first thing you want to do is the Line 6 updater.
Okay. Do I unplug the USB from the computer when I'm installing it?
No.
Okay.
I'll go get the drink. I'll be back.
I swear, like, 9 times out of 10, if somebody's having a problem with the Helix, it's because they're trying to update it and they don't know how.
Yeah.
So that's why I ask questions. I'm not afraid to ask for directions like most guys.
No, I've done it, too. I've been on the group being like, how do you do this? What's going on?
Well, I had issues with my Mac. So on this latest upgrade, I've actually... So how I'm doing it is I'm team viewing into my computer so that I can share it on my Mac, but this is actually where it's sitting.
Oh, cool.
But I'm actually using one of my other, I've got three, there it is.
Three looks like my zillion computers laying around.
Three monitors that I've got, and then I'm actually, that's a team viewer window that's opening this other computer, so...
You gotta be careful doing that. It opens black holes when you have those screens together.
That's where the socks go. Yeah. Where the socks end up.
So what's the biggest problem besides software that anybody's had with their Helix?
Convincing our wives that this is all we need.
Well, it sounds like there's several people who are having a problem with this pedal squeak deal that they're having to send them off or someplace to get that repaired. I've seen several posts about that.
I got one of these in my package. I don't know if that's for that.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. I just
bought the Helix. Loosen that bolt a little bit.
I think loosening the bolt. Loosening the bolt is the I don't know, the fix. Mine's not very tight, but it stays in place, but it doesn't squeak either. I imagine if I tighten it up, I could get it to squeak, but there's no sense in that. Hold on, unmute mine. Go ahead and talk.
That's for you.
Good one. Yeah, if I had his number, I'd just call him.
Press 1 now to learn how to redeem. Press 2 now to be placed on the do not call list.
2-2-2-2-2-2-2
Yeah, do not call, okay. Then how come I pressed it about 1,000 times and I still get phone calls?
Hey, Michael, I liked your little video of the AC-30 sound. Were you playing that through your Marshall? Is that what that was?
Yeah. Did it sound okay?
Yeah, it sounded good.
Because as soon as I heard that, I was thinking, I've got this thing yesterday, and I just started playing with it today, and I've already kind of come up with two ideas for songs in those videos. I'm thinking, wow, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, any product that makes you want to create music is a good product. So.
Oh, yeah.
There you go.
All right, so I downloaded this thing, and what's the thing called, Helix?
Line 6 Updater.
Line 6 Updater. EFGHIJKL. Oh, here we go.
I have to go through the alphabet to find things.
Yeah, I know.
Nothing wrong with that. You're in the right group.
Just think, I miss watching Big Bang Theory for this. This is better tonight. Every time I watch that show, I just want to punch Sheldon right in the throat.
But. So are you guys experiencing still a lot of people that can't get over the whole modeling thing?
Yeah.
Crazy. I don't, because I kind of I shut them down, especially if it's live. If I've got the Helix there going through an amp, I'll say, go ahead, here, let me show you. And they shut up.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, if people are, like, actually listening to it, they won't say anything. But, like, I don't know. It's just annoying to me when people are like, oh, you and your modeling. It's like, well, I'm sorry if I have everything I will ever need.
Really?
Like,
right,
you're
yeah.
You're going to be constantly seeking out some pedal that's going to make your sound, and I'm fine.
Yeah, exactly. I've got every pedal. If we were to take and pile every model that's in the Helix into a pile, the value of what that would be is astronomical.
Who could afford it?
Okay, here. Now what do?
So does it show the Helix in the?
Well, it's on the updater. It says firmware version 1.04.3, local file version 1.10.0. Release date?
No, you want the top one, the 1.11. Or 1.10, sorry. That's the one you want to...
I hit update, right?
Yep.
Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah, I got friends that can afford to buy, like, real boutique amps, but, you know, not everybody has that luxury.
Well, see, here's my point, though, like, yeah, if I had the money, I don't think I'd buy all that stuff. And here's my point is, and this is kind of my mentality, and I know I'm different than a lot of musicians, but my mentality is, I think it's a lot. I'm like a lot of people where we have a family or we have like close neighbors or like we're not. Maybe some of us are like in a little farmhouse in the middle of the woods, and we can play everything as loud as we want. Whenever we want, but like, that's like a great luxury. I don't think a lot of us have. So yeah. Like, and then on top of that, like I have the same mentality when it comes to my electronic drums. I have a Roland kit and I plug it into my Mac, and so I use like Addictive Drums and all these kind of programs, because I'm not going to go out and buy a freaking huge drum set and then all these mics and then sound treat my room.
I've been there and done that. It costs too much and it's a hassle.
Exactly. And the thing is that I can like press a button and I have any drum kit I want.
And the loudest that you'll hear it is to go, that's it.
Exactly.
That's all you'll hear. Yeah.
I don't know why. Like, maybe I just have a complete different mentality of all these things. But
that's
like,
why I bought my drum set back there, and I don't know if you saw this, but I bought this recently, and this is my drum set now.
What is that?
It's called a Zen drum.
That's awesome. What is
it? A mini drum.
You wear it like a guitar, and I plug this up to the Addictive Drums or Superior Drummer, and I can make each one of these pads a different drum, or I can put a saxophone on these things or piano. It's just a controller. That's all it is.
Can you connect a pedal to it?
I'm sorry?
Can you connect a pedal to it?
Yeah.
The bass drum?
I can connect a kick drum pedal and a hi-hat pedal.
That's really cool.
That's awesome.
But my legs are shot from the waist down. I got artificial hips and everything. It's a long story. So I can't sit behind a drum set anymore. So I bought this so I can do my own stuff, you know, because I can't depend on my friends to come over at 3 o'clock in the morning and do, you know, drums for me. So.
Or ever,
yeah.
There you go. So Christian, I agree with you on the whole. Why would I do that thing? I had a USA Fender Tweed DeVille 410, and you know what? To get it to sound good, it has to be really loud. And there's just no my place. I can turn up a little bit, but I agree with you. And plus, it's heavy. And I did get another amp, but I've got the Firehawk, and the Firehawk allows me to get the Helix tones or the Firehawk tones or a blend of both.
So it's an amp too?
Yeah, the Firehawk, Firehawk, it's right here. It's an amp.
You put extra handles on it.
I put extra handles on it, and I put corners on it.
Can you take the front off so I can see? I know you showed it before, but I missed that.
Yeah, let me do that real quick.
Looks heavy.
Yeah, it's 63 pounds, but I've got it on a dolly. You can see at the bottom, I've got it on a dolly.
That's not bad compared to the old PV Mace I had. It was heavy, man. Way too heavy. I used to carry it on foot until I get to one of my friends' house. It's crazy.
So
I could not do
there it is. It's stereo. That's the thing, is it's a stereo FRFR, so it's
FRFR.
And it's it can do wet, dry, wet and everything. And if you want it quiet, it's the same tone that you're getting. You just turn it down.
Well, that's right, yeah. I was talking to you about like the attenuator that Boston uses.
Yeah, so this literally it's just you just turn it down and
power soak. That's really cool.
Yeah, it's not even a power soak. It's just turning it down. It's just loud.
You're not losing any of the dynamics or anything when you do that.
You lose nothing. There's nothing. Wow. It's all modeled.
Now, where'd you get that?
I got it from the Zounds.
Oh, Zounds. Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I deal with Sweetwater.
I got everything from Zounds that I got because the 8 payments or the payment plans.
Yeah.
It's the only way I could have got the Helix. So, but I had to sell my Variax to get the Helix, and I sold some of my other amps. And I'm not looking back at the tube amps. I'm not looking back because the Helix does everything. It sounds amazing. They're making it grow. Sounds good live.
I should get one of those and get rid of some of my other amps because that thing will do everything. I mean, I'm curious.
I have no reason to have any other amps than this.
Really?
It's full range. It's just like a PA, but it's loud. It's 1,500 watts. I guarantee you that I could use that at any large arena because it also has outs. It has main outs.
So I got another question for you. On this thing, it just came up. It says loading the newest factory presets, optional. Should I do that? Because I haven't changed anything on this thing.
Yeah, I would do it. I just hold 9 and or 5 and 6. Hold 5 and 6.
Oh, because it says 7 and 8 on here.
You could do 7 and 8 or even 9 and 10.
Do 9 and 10.
Do 9 and 10.
It's a middle two switches on the bottom row.
The rack or the foot pedal, because the buttons are different.
So on the bottom, it says the two leftmost switches on the bottom row. So that's the bank and...
No. The two center bottom row.
Yeah, the two middle switches on the bottom row, that's 9 and 10.
9 and 10. Wait a minute here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Oh, I didn't realize this thing had 12 buttons on here. Oh, this is so cool.
So you want to do 9 and 10.
Alright.
And so you turn it off, hold
it down. So I turn it on while holding those down, right?
Yeah, you turn it on while holding it down.
The screen should say something like, we'll reset globals and restore stock presets that list in IRs, and you wait for it to do its thing, and it'll give you all the latest presets.
Yeah, and then here's the thing. What I'd like to do is then have your globals set. I'll help you with the globals because one of the things that's important.
As my fingers fall asleep. Okay, now let it up, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so now what? I'm at the... Oh, see, this changed the whole thing here. Well, the first one. Okay.
It should just be like rebuilding your preset.
Yeah, no, you're right. All right, so I go into the three line ones, right?
Yep, and then you go to in
settings.
Yeah, in and out. And the first one is pad. You can pad to taste.
Okay.
But I left my pad off. And then the next one you want to set to auto.
Okay.
And then what's the next one?
Mic in 48 volt fan, and that's off.
And go to the next page. Just page over.
Okay. Line for the quarter inch output.
Set that to instrument.
Oh, okay. Now that brings the volume down, right?
Yeah, but that's okay because you don't want to overextend.
And then the next one says XLR output line.
Mike, put it to Mike.
Wait, what are you connecting? What are you connecting Helix to?
I'm connecting it to my Marshall head.
Are you connecting it right into the front of the Marshall or into
the
effect return? Then yeah, you would have it you would have it set to instrument then.
They told me it's on the return on the back of the head, and on the Helix it's on the quarter inch output.
Yeah. Unless I absolutely need to have something line, I set everything to instrument, and I set the mic level to mic, or set the XLR to mic level.
Okay, the XLR output, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay, and then send. Those are only for external pedals, the send and return buttons, right?
Or other. There's other things you can use them for, like sending.
I can't hook that up into my Marshall head. I tried that. Nothing happens.
You have to add a send return block.
Now, is that better to do that through that?
No, there's no better. There's no better
on every patch.
Sorry.
If you were doing it that way, you'd have to do it on every patch.
Yeah.
Oh, and, I don't want that. Yeah, I'm only doing 32 of them.
Something to consider, Mike. Something to consider is there's really no better or worse way to do something. It's flexible. It does it anyway. But this is the fail-safe way I set it up. And if you find something that does need to have line level, you just turn line level on. But
that's wild. Okay.
But fail safe. So I look at it like this. This is how I look at setting up anything. I want to watch my gain staging. So if I'm going from one device to another or different pedals, I want to make sure, just like for instance, if I ask you how do you make your amplifier that's on the edge of breakup, how do you make it go into overdrive? You overdrive the input. right? So what we're saying is you have your levels. If you send a lower level, some things do need, and I got the discussion with Pierre about it, and I agree with what he's saying. Hey, Eric, how's it going? Am I telling everybody correct, or how's that?
Oh, I got like 8 things going on here, so I'm trying to mention everything.
So basically what I'm saying is...
It really depends on what you're connecting it to. So generally, if you're going to go into, say, a pedal or the front of an amp, anything that would expect an instrument, like anything you would plug a guitar into, say you run a guitar straight into your Marshall, if you're running Helix straight into your Marshall in the same way, you would run those quarter-inch outputs at...
But then I would have to use the EQ on the Marshall, and I just want to use the power amp section, or whatever, the preamp section, or whatever.
So the return jacks on a Marshall are at instrument level, so that's correct, yes.
Oh, okay.
However, say you had studio monitors or a mixer or something like that with quarter-inch inputs, those typically run at line level, so you would want to run those at the output level to get a better signal-to-noise ratio. Otherwise, you're running a much lower signal, so when you try to boost it at the end, either from turning up your speakers or whatever, you end up bringing up the noise as well. So it really just has to do with what you're plugging it into.
Gotcha.
So go ahead.
I was just going to say, so am I correct when I tell people that if you do send a lower signal, you can get the noise floor if you have to turn up and crank the output, but if you're not having that issue, you're probably still okay sending a lesser signal. Am I right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Getting back to the setting on send return 1, 2, 3, 4, just leave them at instrument, you said?
Sure. That's what I do until I need more. Okay.
All right. What about guitar, preamp, SRC, USB 7? What's that?
I would say the rest of the stuff in that particular menu, you can just leave it the way it is.
Oh, okay.
And there's nothing else in there that it's really necessary, probably.
The sample rate, that's just for using, like, for Pro Tools and stuff, right?
That only affects the digital outputs, too, so it only affects the AES and or SPDIF outputs. So if you're not connecting those digital outputs to some other device, you don't even have to touch it.
So do I save it on the unit or just... go back to the three button.
Global settings are automatically saved.
Oh, okay. So I can go back to home and just.
Yep.
Okay. That's way cool.
So here's the trick. So if you're almost all of the presets that are in Helix are using either an amp plus cab or separate amp and cab blocks.
Okay.
The thing is, if you run into the back of the power amp of your Marshall, you're now you're running two power amps. You're running the full power amp section of the preamp model in Helix plus the power amp in the Marshall.
So what does that mean? It's
not going to be ideal. Well, it's like running a power amp into a power amp.
Okay, so if I want the cleanest sound possible, you're suggesting I run it to the front of the amp?
No, I'm saying what you could do is you could, instead of using any of the presets that have full amp plus cab or amp and cab blocks, you might want to start with a preamp block instead.
Let me show you what he's talking about. So I'm going to switch over here. Hold on. I'm going to switch over and show you what he's...
If you don't mind, I got my QuickTime player recorded so I don't forget. So
that's fine. It's going to be rebroadcast anyway. So,
oh, okay.
So what he's saying here is, let me take a brand new patch. He's saying when you want to add a block, and add a block in here.
Now, how did you get 78 of the? Oh, I'm sorry, never mind.
Yeah. So what he's saying is you can either put an amp or a cab or just an amp. But what he's saying is go to the preamp and put a preamp in here. So that way you're putting the preamp into your power amp of your Marshall.
Okay, how do you do a new preset? That's where I'm stuck at.
Just move down and go to a new preset.
Okay. All mine are taken up, though.
Okay, look what I'm doing here.
The top.
Mike, look what I'm doing.
Got user 2. Oh, user 2, I got you. Oh, yeah.
So you can change the right there.
Well, I can have different setups for different guitars.
Yeah. You can have it do anything you want.
All right, so let's just, for instance, 1A. Let's start with that. As soon as you show me this, I'll be able to do it next time, so I won't have to bug you again.
So what you want to do is you pick, say, user bank 4, right?
Okay.
And then you just go to 1A.
Right.
Right? And then you come and you add whatever block you want to add right here, so whatever one you want, and you put a preamp.
How do you get to that part? Because all I have here is input, and I have the input gate threshold and the multi guitar aux.
Move across and click on the line.
You just have to double click on the line.
Oh, okay.
Double click.
Oh, I see what it's doing. Okay, so it starts off with. Oh, okay. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Is there any special order that you're supposed to put these in?
It's whatever your heart desire, but.
I'm going to hear that a lot, aren't I?
Yeah. So the best thing to do is so let's just look at templates. There's
okay.
There's just different templates here that you can do. So like there's four guitar.
Okay.
You can see now you have a guitar input, a mic input, an auxiliary input, and a return or a I can't quite see what it's saying.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, return 3 and 4.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, and then it's also going out to 4 different things.
So, in other words, you have to have a degree to use this and Logic Pro.
Well, not really. It takes a little bit of sitting down with it and learning it.
Yeah.
But that's what the group's there. We can help you through anything.
Yeah. I mean, this is literally my first day doing this, so forgive my greenness.
No. That's what we're all here for. And,
I also found some. Who's the guy? Glenn. Somebody that works for Lines. Glenn. Yeah, I watched some of his things. I'm gonna probably get a bunch of his. I also found this thing called you guys sent me called Own Hammer.
Yeah, the reflex.
Yeah,
I think there's so much built into Helix. I think there's a real rush to go for the reflex stuff before people have even played with what's inside the box.
Yeah.
So why bother to load 1,000 variables in before you try it?
Well, I found, you know, Glenn's Joe Bonamassa sound and his Gary Moore sound are pretty good.
Yeah, and they use just what's inside the Helix.
Yeah.
Yeah, so
Michael, I will warn you that there's something that at least I know I do, and I'm sure you guys do as well. It's called option paralysis. So because you have so many things that you it won't be a waste. It'll be a fun time, but you'll realize that you just spent 2 hours playing like the same riff, and you're just tweaking around, and then you'll come back the next day, and then you'll be like. Oh, that's different, and I don't know. It's really a good idea to just like find a good sound, and then you know, just play with it for a little while, and
see what I love.
I know at least for me, like I think what we sometimes tend to do is like, we just like tinker too much, and it's really hard because the Helix can be tinkered with so much. But like it's so hard to go. Okay, that sounds good. I'm gonna go record something. I'm gonna go make music. It's more just like,
you're right.
Play with this all day long, and you know we could do both. We could play all day long, or we could make music, and you know we're all free to do that.
I don't want to reinvent the wheel. I just want to be able to get some good tone, and you know I don't want to be like Eddie Van Halen, who's been a tone chaser his whole life.
Well, see, that's the other thing that I think that a lot of people don't really think about, and it kind of goes back to what I was saying earlier, is that at the end of the day, if we're making music. How is that music going to be listened to?
Right.
You know, that'd be great if we can all play live and bands and stuff. But even our favorite music, what are we doing? We're listening to it in our car, on our headphones.
Doing speakers. Yeah.
Yeah, and you're not standing in front of your, you know, full stack amp listening to your guitar tone all the time. You're like you're listening to it after it's been recorded, but like by a band. And so like at the end of the day, it's like. All these people complain about, like, oh, it's doesn't feel like not the Helix necessarily, but even with the HD500X, people will complain and say like, oh, it just doesn't feel like an amp. I'm like, okay, well, that's like apples and oranges, because you're not really supposed to compare it to an amp. You're supposed to compare it to an amp that's being mic'd up in another room.
That's like when I used to play at church, there came a point where they wouldn't allow us to have our amps on stage. And we had to use earbuds, and I had the little Lima Bean Line 6 thing. And I used to have my monitor, a little tiny, like a PV Classic, pointing up at me so I could feel it. And once I started doing the earbuds, I just said, you know what, I'm not doing this, because I can't, I want to feel the, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I've gotten used to using earbuds and headphones and different things and just being in this little room, and, you know, so I'm not real picky about it anymore. But, you know, if it sounds good to me, it's going to sound good.
Okay, so here's my take on the whole IR situation. You've got, like, with the Redwire's IRs that I have, I was like 30,000 of these speaker moments captured in time where the on cone, off cone, 1 inch, 2 inch, this mic, that mic. So here's what I did is when I first discovered the IRs, I was like, wow, this IR sounds so much better than the Helix. But then I went back and I realized it wasn't the particular IR that sounded better. It was that I like 412 cabs. I like the tone that the 412 cab gives me. When I was comparing apples to oranges, I was comparing this 412 cab to Line 6's 112 per se on a given amp. So when I actually switched over and started using comparing more apples to apples, there wasn't that big a difference. And Digital Igloo, if you can correct me here, if there's any what I say here. What I believe that Line 6 has done is they've captured many, many IRs into their speaker cab, and so when you change the mic or when you change the distance, you are essentially grabbing a different IR. Am I correct?
It's a little bit more complicated than that, but it's safe to think.
That's what the Kemper does, by the way, and that's why I didn't get the Kemper, because it only takes a little snapshot of something instead of get the panoramic view. Like the
Let's let Eric talk real quick.
No, I mean that's it's more complicated than that, but that it's not inaccurate at all now.
Okay, good. Yeah. Oh, no, I realize there's a lot more to it, but I'm trying to bring it down into the simplest understanding. Is there's just a lot of different IRs. Of course, I think I applaud how Line 6 did this. It gave us a lot of options. But as Christian was saying, option paralysis can set in, plus ear fatigue. Mm-hmm. You're listening and listening and you're listening and you're listening, you're dialing it in, you're listening, and you go, that sounds horrible. And you come back a day later, it sounds good, or vice versa. You're like, oh, I love this, and you come back and go, what was my ear even thinking?
That's just like a big thing.
Actually, Eric, I did have a quick question. This is one of my favorite presets. I got a picture of it on the it's that Mandarin Gaze one.
Oh, that's I think that's Phil's. I think that's Phil Miller's preset.
My question is this. If you guys can see, it's hard because of my phone, but now it's going from this up here is the amp block, like the head, and then it looks like it's like sending effects before the speaker. The speakers are at the very end.
Yeah.
I never thought to do that. It sounds amazing. I use it for church all the time. I don't know. I was just like,
there are two different approaches. A lot of people like putting, especially if you're used to pedals before an amp, or putting pedals into an effects loop in an amp, you're hearing the actual effects coming out of the speaker. So that particular preset would reflect that sort of tonality. Anytime you see effects after the cab, think of that generally as you're miking a cab in the recording studio. It's coming into the big recording console, and then you're adding rack mount processing to it, to the recording of that amp, if that makes sense.
Oh, that makes a lot more sense.
Between treating those effects as a pedal or treating those effects as a rack. And we don't really differentiate between the two. I mean, a model is a model.
Yeah.
So if they come before the amp cab, like you said, it's like it's coming out of the effects loop, you said, right?
Or it could be just before. Yeah, so if you have your preamp and then you have pedals and then you have your cab, you could almost treat it like those pedals are in the effects loop in the amp, yeah.
Okay, that makes more sense.
Well, not quite, because the amp actually includes the power amp. So it's not quite, because typically in the effects loop, it's between the preamp and the power amp. So it's not quite the same thing, but it's close enough for rock and roll.
And so one of the things to consider when you do that is if you do apply, like I say, making the low cut and the high cut of the speaker, the cab, to match what a guitar speaker does, then you will affect everything that's coming through that guitar speaker, and it will limit the frequency response, so that if you put the effects after the speaker, you're going to get those higher and lower sounds. So if you leave the speaker cab completely open as far as its frequency response, then you can put it in between or after and get you're going to get still different sounds, right?
Like using your reverb on your amp versus putting a studio reverb on when you're recording.
Right.
There, I'll tell you guys about this real quick. I'm going to make a new video about it soon. There's one thing I've been doing with the Helix that's really cool. I've been trying to experiment with the fact that you can have all these different stereo paths, and the one preset I have worked on right now, it's really cool because I have a good like metal rock tone, and what I wanted to do is I wanted to kind of put some synthy sounds underneath it. But the problem when you do that kind of stuff is that you get it just gets muddy and everything gets really bad because you're throwing these weird synthy like big chorusy kind of things in. So what I did was on one stereo path I have that great tone by itself. And then on a completely different path, I have the same input coming in, but now on that path, all it has is like I have the 5150 on the top one, top path, and on the bottom path, I have like a Fender clean, but then on all I have is the octo verb, and I just have the like effect really high. I have it all 100% wet for that one path, and so you're not really getting any of the tone. You're just getting all that octo reverb, and it sounds amazing because you have a really nice clean path that's giving you all that really good chunkiness and lead, but then you have this really cool underneath it synth sound. So I'll do a video soon to show you guys what it sounds like and everything, but
I've
had so much fun with it.
What's that? As we were saying earlier on, we use a GR55, and I have a similar patch where we just have a guitar coming in on the top, but we have the GR55 coming on the bottom with the synth tones.
Yeah.
Right. If I can move the camera, it might be, I don't know.
And one of doing that, can I ask you, could you post that particular gaze thing up on the site, the whatever you showed us?
Oh, that's a preset.
But I've created that, so I'm trying to get it in focus with the camera. I can't figure out the mirror image of the way to move it.
You
see that guy? You've got the guitar coming in on the top with the amps and stuff, but on the bottom you've got no amp. You're just feeding through the synth tones with a few reverb or echo.
Now, Michael, right. This is the kind of stuff we were talking about, that like you can do so many amazing things with this, or you can just make it simple and get good sounds. So if some of this seems like too much or too complicated...
Well, one of the other things that I like to do is... and I'll show an example of it, is a parallel where you take your delay, and let me see if I find it here. I've got one here. Let me show you. You take your delay, instead of running your delays into the verb, present to everyone. Okay. So what you do is let's just say this wasn't here. you actually have your tones coming in, you get your IRs and your send returns, and it goes to path 2, and then it hits the delay, and you see the path comes down and hits the delay, but the delay comes after the sound comes back in, after the verb. So your delays are crystal clear delays. They don't get all muddied up with the reverb.
And so the tails are not as long, right?
Well, not necessarily tails are not as long, but it just doesn't interfere. The reverb hits the reverb at its own sound, and then the delays are sitting there kind of riding on top. Plus, it lowers the value of the of how much it's in the tone. So you're just kind of sitting there on top. That's one of the things I like to do. It makes it sound clearer. It's called a parallel path.
How do you guys figure this out? Just by doing it, I guess, right?
I figured out that parallel path thing that Chad was talking about by watching Sean Haley. Haley do it. Yeah.
Yeah. When he did that, it was like a revelation during that one presentation he was doing. It was like, oh, that's beautiful. That's great.
What's the guy's name? Sean Hadley?
Hallie.
Hallie, okay.
Chad, how are you doing your editor to the screen rather than having to point the camera at it?
So what you do is on the, I'll show you like right here. On your Google menu, you've got the screen share.
Oh, wow. Check that out.
At the left-hand side?
Yeah, on the left side, yeah. You hit this little arrow.
Oh, yeah, okay. Brilliant. Thank you.
Yeah. And so you can share it. You can share that.
Yeah, it would have been easy to show you on the app, the patch, instead of doing all the stupid camera moving stuff.
Yeah. Wow. I've got a quick question for Digital Igloo, if you can still hear us.
I am here, yeah.
Yeah, just want to know, are you the guy behind the Line 6 videos online?
Oh, no, that's Sean Halley.
No, okay, because you have the voice is similar, so I wasn't
oh,
sure.
Oh, what's going on? Sean and I went to lunch.
Us Americans, we sound alike.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, we all sound alike.
Okay. Yeah, you got a deep voice like him. He's got a deep voice to him.
No, Sean's a great guy.
Yeah.
He just got back from Music Mesa, so.
Oh, is that the guy who he's got the curly hair? He does stuff for Roland, too, doesn't he?
No.
No, that's Johnny DeMarco, and Johnny's a buddy of mine, too.
Okay, yeah.
I was a Roland for 5 years before Line 6, so.
Oh, you're that guy. I got you. Okay.
No, I have voice.
No. Sorry. You wear the thumb ring, right?
Nope. I don't think I'm in any Line 6 videos other than like 10 seconds here and there. So.
Okay. Maybe you're not the guy. Sorry.
Eric, Line 6 has to make like a Line 6 electronic drum set. I'm sure that would sell. I'd buy it because I buy everything Line 6. So.
Well, so here's the trick there. Yamaha, even if we wanted to, I doubt it. That's sort of Yamaha's wheelhouse. That's not to say that we haven't talked, you know, about projects we might be able to do together or other things and that sort of stuff. For the most part, they're really hands off. You know,
I was gonna say, how is that going? It seems
there's actually a big Yamaha concert down in Orange County right now. They where everybody kind of carpooled down and they get a bunch of big artists to hang out. And I had too much work to do tonight, so
I decided
to forego that, but. That's all right, but no, Yamaha's great. They let us do our thing, and distribution in Europe is ramping up, which is really nice. They also get us into parts of the world that we've never been in before, too. I know Marcus had a bunch of meetings at Music Mesa, talking to a bunch of people all over in the Middle East, Southeast Asia, you know, parts of Africa. So we're gonna see more Line 6 stuff there too, with Yamaha's help. So.
And do they give you, like, you know, dirt bikes to hang out with?
We do get a deal on Yamaha gear, actually. And one of my buddies got a Yamaha motorcycle. Not a huge discount, but enough to make it worth it, you know?
There you go. I used to have a YZ250 dirt bike, so I kind of miss
it. Nice.
All right, guys. Well, it was fun hanging out. I'm going to get going, so see you guys.
Thanks, Christian.
Right.
Thanks for your help.
Yep.
Nice
see you guys.
Meeting you. So how about Line 6 make some monitor speakers? That would be good.
We do, L2Ts. There are actually a few studios who are using L2s as studio monitors.
But they're big, they got high enemy and very loud. Yeah.
Yeah. The thing, I don't know, the thing with studio monitors is unless you have the resources like Yamaha where you can actually create your own transducers and create your own amplifier circuits, the vast majority of especially affordable studio monitors are just rehashed, rebranded Chinese knockoffs. Okay. That you slap your name on it, you do a little bit of voicing, and you're like, oh yeah, check it out, here's our studio monitor. So
like what Sam
it's tough to compete with that kind of, you know, it's tough to do something brand new and unique, and it's a really saturated market. I don't know that we'd ever get into it.
I'm trying to find a solution for low volume music at home in my apartment. So far I'm using some monitor speakers from M-Audio, the AV40, which they're good. Yeah, it was way too loud.
No, M-Audio speakers are good. I mean, it depends on what type of price point you're looking at. I'm a personal fan of DynAudios and Atoms and Eve Audios.
Well, I like the Firehawk. I saw it. It looks great. Well, Chad show it to us, but a little bit too high wattage for my taste for my apartment. Even if he says we can play low volume, but still... I would like a solution from 96 with a
plug
smaller
into
amp, maybe. Like the Amplify. The Amplify 30 is great, but there's no inputs for the Helix.
But in terms of monitor speakers, Yamaha do a nice set of 5-inch monitors.
Yep.
Which are perfect for apartments.
Actually, Sebastian,
the L308s, but they also do a 5-inch version of the 8-inch series.
I've got these JBLs that are real nice. I don't know what models they are, but they're...
They look exactly identical to mine. Are they the 308s?
Yeah, that's it. Yep.
Yeah.
It's the best.
Are you the exact same thing with a 310 subwoofer?
Yep, and then I got these Presonus ones that are pretty neat. They're like...
Presonus.
No, they didn't cost that much. And then I got these little clips. I got those from Best Buy. But I like these JBLs. They're really nice, and they sound great.
Sebastian, you could actually get two of the new Line 6 Amplify 30s, and turn off all the modeling, and then just go left and right into those.
Is it their stereo actually? Yeah.
Well, they're stereo, yes, but if you get two of them, you put one on left.
Two, yeah. It will cost a lot to get that effect, yeah. Yeah, one day maybe. I have no room anyway to put any of that stuff. I'm still in the kitchen, like I said. I have to wait until my son gets out of the home, but that's not before a couple of years.
So, Eric, is there any secret to the looper? I find that the looper doesn't put out the same tones as what I put into it.
Where is the looper? Is it pre or post?
Post or pre. It sounds like it's like less. It's like it's a little muddier than what I put in. Listening to the tones that I put into it, and then when I play it back, it's always less.
And that it doesn't matter what the looper is set to. So the playback and overdub are both set to 0 dB.
Right. I mean, I can test it later, but it's just I.
That's not something I've heard about before, but
let me look at it here. Put one in there. Looper. The looper. Okay. Let's go mono looper. Okay. Yeah. Zero dub. So like I guess I'll gotta assign a pedal for that. Hold on. Let's switch sign. Here it is.
Wait, and this is a serial path or a parallel path?
Right now I'm just going in. It's a parallel path, but I'm coming in after it merges back.
Okay.
Well, it sounds identical.
It's hard to tell from here. I know there's always the sound of the acoustic strings in the room too, so you're never going to hear it when it comes back.
Right,
so
yeah.
There could be a psychoacoustic element there as well, but if there is a sonic difference and it's measurable, if it's something you can record and send to our CS guys, I'm sure we can take a look at it.
Okay, yeah. And it's possible that maybe, because I literally haven't used too much of the looper, it may have been the way I had it set.
So there are some presets where the looper is on a parallel path, and what happens is when you split a parallel path, it actually drops each path by 3 dB, so when you merge it back together, it...
Oh, I lose the sound.
Hold on.
What happened here?
Eric, if you can hear us, you need to unmute yourself. Somebody muted you.
Oh, here I am.
There you are.
So if you happen to have a looper on a parallel path, when you split into two parallel paths, what happens is it actually drops each path by 3 dB, because when you merge it back together, it goes back up to unity. So if you happen to have that looper on one of those two paths, that path is 3 dB down.
Gotcha.
Any processing that happens to be on that path, it'll loop that, but not what's on the other path. So you'll be hearing the stuff in real time. But then when it comes back, you'll only hear half of the signal. And it could be much less than the half of the signal, depending on what processing is on those different paths. So.
Okay, gotcha. So that may have been what I was doing. So that clears it up. I'm glad to get that information straight from the line six, because there's not a lot in the manual to kind of tell you about the looper. Oh, okay, this is one thing. Clearing. I can't find it in the manual. How do you get what is played? I know there's undo, but is there like a thing? Because I know that I can always still press, like if I hit undo now, and it's still there.
Mm-hmm.
So is there a way just to clear it off?
There's no clear function, because you can only have one loop in memory at any given time anyway.
Okay.
And it's also not stored across power cycles. So the only way to clear a loop is to record a new one, which would be making sure that you stop loop playback and then hit record again, and it replaces it.
Oh, okay, perfect. That explains it. Okay. Is there? I know you can't speak to future developments, but man, I won't ask. But what I would say is, I would love to see a combo pedal, like a Helix Edition pedal, that had the features of some of the more advanced loopers, with two expression pedals that would interconnect with the Helix in some way.
Well, that's what's kind of cool about Helix too, in that, I mean, obviously, you know, loopers are things that we've talked about, and the list of features that we've talked about potentially including in Helix is literally hundreds of items long, many hundreds of items long. And we're constantly moving things up and down the list and figuring out, okay, this is going to take X number of weeks to develop, or let's go and do a search on IdeaScale, let's go talk to some people, let's talk to the beta testers, the Line 6 experts, that kind of thing, and figure out exactly what our next thing should be. Loopers have never left the list. We think they're really cool. What's nice about the UI in Helix, however, is, let's say we wanted to do some sort of crazy multi-track looper, because of the scribble strips, we can do whatever we want, because we're not restricted by silkscreen.
Yes.
So, awesome. So those screens can say anything we want. I mean, we don't have any imminent plans necessarily, but you could imagine that four of the switches could be four tracks, and the other four switches could be reverse for each of those four tracks, or, you know, who knows.
And is there a way to expand, like, is the Helix powerful enough, architecture that if say you wanted to expand minutes, you could add a way to connect it through either USB or some way to add more space to have more time?
No, unfortunately, the looper time is what it is. I mean, presumably we could potentially steal from Flash or do some sort of like RAM-based crossfade where it uses a RAM buffer that then crossfades into the Flash memory. It's pretty complicated. Not that we haven't. That's something that we actually used to do with our JM4 looper, which actually used a Flash card, removable card. But when you're triggering and when you're recording and playing back in real time, it has to be as fast as triggering a sample, and Flash just isn't fast enough for that. You need some sort of RAM buffer. So that's something we maybe could do. There hasn't been too much discussion on that, but...
Well, you know, I find that it's got a very utilitarian use, and, but the beautiful thing about the Helix is you've got the four ins and outs that if you did want to put a looper in, you could put it and put it where you want and activate it. With the connection between this and the Firehawk, I have to say you guys have knocked it out of the ballpark. The Firehawk is just, even standalone is incredible.
Yeah, I mean Firehawk is an interesting box. It's one of those things that even if you were to just ignore all of the DSP that's built in, there's still a big portion of that DSP required just for the speaker management, just to be able to get sound out of it and make it sound wet, dry, wet, and stereo and actually flatten the frequency response so it actually is true FRFR and, you know, and all of the both analog and digital tuning that we did to the speaker. So it's less of a Firehawk 1500 with a speaker and more like a hardcore high-end FRFR with wet, dry, wet capabilities that just happens to have a modeling engine built in. You could almost treat it like a bonus if you had a Helix or if you had Axe FX or Kemper or Amplifier or something like
yes,
that.
Yes, and that's actually what I've done is I've actually been able to go and create a wet, dry, wet patch that can actually pull in some of the effects and put it back in through the Helix before the amplifier and then back out into the Firehawk, and it was pretty cool. So I was able to have an auto wah and all sorts of things using the Helix amp model.
Cool, absolutely.
Yeah, so I mean, it's truly the two together are pretty incredible. So yeah, when people say, well, yeah, but if it didn't have the Firehawk, I might think it's just a bonus. You can use it or not.
And honestly, if we were to totally, I've mentioned this before on the forums, if we were to totally just remove the Firehawk modeling engine, it's not going to save any more than maybe $100.
Right.
Maybe use a less expensive DSP, which might be a couple bucks savings, you know, on parts pricing. Remove a couple LEDs. Maybe get rid of the display. But I mean, it's not a night and day. Once you've done all of the work to make the speaker and the management, you're 90% of the way there. So.
Right. Yeah, and again, in its own right, without using the Helix, just straight in. I went to band practice last Friday, and it kept pace with my buddy's tube amp, so no problems. I mean, it sounded amazing.
Sure.
So,
Eric, just changing tack a bit. One of the problems I'm finding with the Helix coming as a guitarist and not as a keyboards player, I really could do with some extra information on the MIDI messages and capabilities that you can transmit to other devices to try and use it as a control center.
Sure. Oh, just a kind of generic. What is it capable of doing? Well, you're not going to be sending complex system exclusive strings or anything like that, but the big thing is that you can assign any command you want to any of the foot switches per preset, but then in addition, each preset has 6 instant commands that are buffered, so when you recall that preset, it can spit out 6 commands to any number of devices, and this can be either via the 5-pin MIDI DIN on the back, or it can be via USB to your DAW. So you could use it to control logic.
I'm connecting it. I'm connecting to Cubase 8.5 via a native instruments user interface, the native 6. I'm going out. I've got a MIDI connection to a GR55.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to be able to change from the Helix the GR55 patches. As I change the patch on the Helix to tell the GR55 to change to a certain patch, and I just cannot for the life of me figure out how to do it.
Okay, so there's a global setting in the... If you go to global settings on the MIDI page, there's a transmit receive MIDI PC. What that does is when you change presets in Helix, it always, by default, sends out a program change message. So what happens is if you happen to go to the command center and send a specific PC message to recall a specific preset in an external device, what happens is the receiving device is receiving two messages, receiving the overall generic one that you get every time you send out a message, and it's also resending the one that's in the command center. So it could simply be that you're sending two messages.
Okay.
So if you want to do everything from command center, you'd want to turn off in global settings, MIDI tempo, it's called MIDI PC send receive. You'd turn that off. What that means is that when you change presets in Helix, it doesn't automatically spit out a program change message by default. And then you can use command center to send those messages, and then it'll only send those messages.
Okay, so that's effectively first page of the MIDI tempo and then button 4, the MIDI PC send receive, which is automatically on. Turn that off.
Turn that off.
Okay.
Now, I mean, there are a million other things it could be if it's hooked up into Cubase and Cubase happens to have MIDI through on, it could be kicking that back into Helix. And then if MIDI through is on, which is knob 2, then it would cause a MIDI feedback loop. So,
right.
So it'd be a good idea to maybe turn that off too. So
what you're saying is that I can hook up, just like what's his name, Gary, can hook up the GR55 to the Helix and control the descent from that?
Yeah, absolutely. The only thing you can't control in the GR55, I think GR55, somebody had requested sending pitch messages to it, which I thought was interesting, something we hadn't thought of because so few other guitar processors respond to pitch bend changes, but Roland's do, so that's something we're considering adding. But for the most part, it's going to respond to, you know, program changes, continuous controller messages. I know Roland's stuff responds to a ton of system-exclusive data. Like, if you look in the back of their MIDI implementation chart, it's just got every single possible thing in it. It's system-exclusive, and that's probably beyond the scope of 99% of our users, but...
crazy. And in terms of stopping the GR55, changing the Helix, so if you change something on the GR55, how'd you stop it changing the Helix?
If you have one cable, so if you go MIDI out of Helix to the MIDI in of the GR55, you don't have to worry about it because MIDI is only one direction.
Okay.
You just not send a MIDI cable from GR55 back to Helix. So you just hook up one cable and you don't have to worry about it.
Brilliant.
Man.
That's what the
Helix is. Is there anything that Helix can't do?
Tons, hundreds and hundreds of things.
Yeah. I asked the Helix today to make me breakfast. It just sat there.
It won't loop more than 30 seconds. Eric, one more question on the MIDI. With the GR55, if you wanted to actually, though, send a MIDI message to Cubase so it could record something, if you'd only got the cable going from the Helix to the GR55, what would happen?
You can do a couple things. You can have Cubase connected via USB. You can have the GR55 connected via MIDI.
Yeah.
And you could control both of them simultaneously. By default, Helix sends MIDI data out both USB and MIDI.
Yeah, can you MIDI through from the GR55, right?
I don't believe the GR55.
Part on the GR55 and have Cubase record it in MIDI. How do I pass it through the Helix without the Helix responding to the GR55 other message?
At that point, if you need bidirectional communication between both Helix and GR55, you likely want to get a dedicated MIDI interface for your computer.
Okay.
Now I take the bet. So Roland is pretty clever. Roland actually does on occasion allow for its own MIDI ports to act as additional ports to the computer. I know their Phantom G did that. A lot of their synths do that. I don't know if any of their guitar synths do that, but it might be worth a perusal in the manual. And by that I mean, if you were to connect Helix, both ports of Helix, in and out to in to the GR55 and the GR55's USB to the computer, it could be that those ports on the GR55 are indeed additional ports to the computer.
Right.
So you can use those ports as a MIDI interface. Helix wasn't designed to do that. We tried to keep things simple.
I have one more question, then I'll shut up the rest of the night. Can I get an understanding of how to import? I found some Taylor guitar IRs. How do you import them?
Okay.
Go ahead, Chad.
Let me go to that.
I'm just going to say goodnight to y'all because it's 1:36 in England here and I've got work in the morning.
Wow. All right, Gary. Nice meeting
okay,
you.
Okay, so I'm going to bow out.
Good okay, day.
Good day.
Okay, so pretty much, Mike, you basically can come over here and you move your screen to impulse, right?
Okay.
And then I will lower this down a little bit. Don't look at the big mess. It's a big mess. I'll go into my Helix data, wherever that is. Let's see. Tons of stuff, but hang on. I get my Helix. I6 Helix. So here's some IRs that I've got in here, right?
Yeah, I got the Taylor 314 like you do.
Okay, so let me pull open that screen a little bit and just lower it down a little. Hang on. There we go. Oops. Brain's not working. Hold on. There we go. So I just get it to where I shrink the screen up, and then I can grab any of these IRs, but let's just go into the Taylors, and I'm just going to highlight them all. As you can see, I'm grabbing all of them, and then I just drag and drop right in there.
Oh, okay. And they're all WAV files, right?
Yeah. And so now that they're there, I can actually go into the IR, and I can hit, hold on, let's expand this.
Do you have to drag them, or can you just hit open?
No, you just drag and drop them, and it'll place it right over the top, and then you can just choose what IR you're going for. See, I can highlight the different IRs and choose.
Oh. Hey, Chad, there's a cool shortcut, too. From the IR list off to the left, you can drag one of those directly down to where it says IR select, and then you can drag them straight onto it if you'd like. Instead of having to drag the dial.
Oh, so you can just pick one up.
Yep, there you go.
Oh, really? Wow.
There you go. That's cool. Wow. Okay.
Oh, wow.
Drop some new stuff. Now, is that just with the IRs, or is that with other things too?
That's the only thing that has a list off to the left other than presets, which don't apply. So.
Gotcha. Okay, perfect.
Wow.
Now, do these actually sound like real acoustic, transparent kind of, glassy acoustic sounds, or is it just, I don't know.
These are what we would call acoustic. These particular ones are called acoustic IRs, and maybe Eric could explain the difference between an acoustic IR versus a standard IR.
Well, an IR, all it really is it's an impulse that the best way to describe it is it's a snapshot of that particular frequency response at any given time. So they're very, very short recordings, and if you happen to apply that particular file, the convolution engine can interpret that wave file and then apply it to your signal in real time. It was originally used for reverb. Sony had this $8,000 SRV-777 thing or whatever, and then it ended up in Altiverb, and now it's built into all the DAWs, all the recording software. And you can use, and now people are using them to emulate cabinet mic cable mic pre-signal paths. That's what the Onehammer and Redwire IRs traditionally are. But you can basically IRize anything, for lack of a better word. So in Space Designer that comes with Logic, if you go through it, it has not just convolution reverbs, but you'll see that they have transistors, yeah, and op amps and all sorts of weird little buzzy things that they've effectively sampled and turned into impulse responses.
Is that kind of like what the PV did with the rewire thing?
I don't know if PV does impulse responses or not. They do traditional just component-based modeling as far as I'm aware.
Can we use these IRs as, can we download a reverb IR and put it in and make it seem like that, or is that not possible with these IRs?
You can, but it's going to be way too short to hear.
Okay,
So we support IRs. So what happens is when you load an IR, it doesn't matter how long it is, we shorten it or lengthen it to 2048 points or 2048 samples, which is just a few milliseconds. When you're dealing with reverbs, you're talking, you know, in the tens of thousands of samples.
Right. Okay. Gotcha. Okay. So can you explain the difference between the 1024 and the 204A? Is it just amount of time?
Yeah. It's the best advice I can give is it's going to create a 2048 anyway. What happens when you happen to choose the 1024 version? Uses the exact same file. It just crossfades halfway through. So what you could try is you could load both into your preset and then sign both of them to a foot switch, bypass one of them, and toggle back and forth to see if you can tell a difference. Most people can't tell. So if you can tell, then cool, use the 2048. Otherwise, always use the 1024 because you'll get it uses half the DSP horsepower.
That's what I was going to ask. Is it uses less DSP? Using the smaller one is really not tonally that much different.
It depends on the IR. It depends on the listening environment. It depends on your ears.
Right. So
how do you load the impulses up? I'm trying to understand how you load these things up.
Okay. So do you have it loaded into your impulses?
Yeah, I have all seven of them.
Okay, so let me show you. Let me show you one more. You go in, and we'll show everybody. You want to take and I'm going to still delete these here. You just take and double click on where you want it, and you go down and you find impulse response.
Oh, okay. So everything works off this block system.
Yeah, and then you. You do the 1024, and then you can drag and drop the one that you want in there.
What do you mean 1024? I don't understand.
Okay, look.
I'm not just talking about it, but I'm not sure I understand what that meant.
So just follow. If you can see, follow along with what I'm saying. Double click on it, and then you want to add an impulse response mono, and then you see there's two choices.
Okay.
One uses twice the DSP, but you know, that's just for the sake of DSP level, we'll choose 1024.
Okay.
Now we're on 1024, and then you go up and find the one that you want, and you just drag it. You drag and drop it.
Okay.
Or you can just take and move the little arrow and choose the one that's there.
So if I want to use a Neumann U87, I just drop it on the top line.
Yeah.
Which is IR select.
Yeah.
And then that changes everything. Okay. But what does that do as far as the blocks and different things like that? Or is this just like something that's aside from that?
There's just a block is a block. It's a place you put an effect. So.
Oh, okay. But on top of like this Mandarin gaze thing I found, it won't affect that, will it?
No, typically this, if you're using an acoustic IR, yeah. It's not something you generally have like a distortion pedal and an amp on. It's meant to take your guitar and then, you know, emulate the frequency response of an acoustic. So maybe a bit of compression or EQ and that sort of stuff. So
I would basically put this on a new preset, like user preset one.
Yep.
Right.
Oh, okay. Oh, I see. Okay, I gotcha.
Hey, guys, I'm going to go. So have a good night, Al.
Thanks, Sebastian.
Nice talking to you guys. Nice meeting
you. Glad you're
here. Good night. See you next time.
Sounds good.
Bye. Okay, I think I understand this. And just lay it on top. What if I do it on the low cut, or it just goes on the IR select, basically?
IR select. That's, you're just choosing the type. Those low cut and high cut and mix, those are just parameters that you use to control the tone.
So if I plug my acoustic into this, it's going to sound like an acoustic. If I plug my Les Paul into it, it'll sound like something that has a piezo bridge on it, right?
No.
Oh.
Your electric guitar will not sound like a piezo bridge. It's just going to sound different. It's not going to sound like an acoustic. But
so if I plug this into it, then it's going to sound like an acoustic.
Obviously. Yes, it's going to change the tonal features of your acoustic piezo pickup.
I just want to see how this works, because I might have one more question. I know I said I'd shut up. I'm sorry.
Hey, that's what we're here for.
Okay.
Although I think those Taylor IRs were designed to turn an electric guitar into an acoustic guitar. Is that right?
No. You know what? I found that they don't work that well doing that. They're just more. They seem to me to make the acoustic guitar just have more body or something. Kind of like, gotcha. Yeah.
Okay, but how do I hear this? Because it's not.
If you're going through your Marshall, it's not going to sound the greatest anyway. These would probably need more of a full range flat response.
No, I just want to see if it works though, and I don't hear anything. Oh, here we go. Okay, and I can go in and change different, you know, like.
Yeah, and you can add compression or delays.
Okay.
That's
cool.
This is just basically like replacing the speaker that you would just on the cab, you know, speaker cab. Yeah.
So I can get rid of my Royer mics and my 414 mics now. I can just get rid of all this stuff because of this Helix.
Unless you have a specific need, yeah.
Yeah, man, I'll be able to get okay. I'm just blown away at what this thing can do. I'm just like. I don't know. I'm going to be geeking out on this for the next long period of time. That's all I know.
Well, that's good. That's what it's there for. It's a tinker.
Yeah.
Have fun. So I know that all of us would love to hear, and I know you might not be able to say, but are we in for a new firmware with new features coming soon, or?
Soonish, maybe. So I'd mentioned the timeline somewhere. I have to follow. I don't have to. I follow way too many forums. Effectively, the first thing we need to do is make sure that we get the feature complete version of the Helix editor out.
Right.
So I don't know if you guys saw, but we released the Mac driver today.
I did. Now if you. Give us the lowdown. What exactly will that do for us?
It's not going to do much unless you're recording high sample rates in DAWs. So if you're using 88.2 or 96K on, you know, in Logic or Pro Tools or something like that, and you need to use Helix as your audio interface or as an aggregate device with other interfaces.
Yes.
There were quite a few issues that were solved when Apple released 10.11.4. A lot of the issues that people attributed to us were, quite frankly, just El Capitan just not cooperating. And there have been horror stories across the industry, but 10.11.4 seems to be a lot better. We didn't want to wait, though, so we decided let's make our own driver, and so that's what came out today.
Oh, nice.
So that's also public beta. I also got this isn't for the public yet. We're hoping in the next week or two we should get another feature complete version of the editor out. I got to play with it today. It was a lot of fun. A lot of key commands are back in there. You can custom label scribble strips.
Ooh, nice.
You can custom label, or you can move the colors now. It's super fast to label stuff. All of the blocks now sync, so you can use the arrow keys on your keyboard, and you can navigate all of the blocks, and the hardware will follow, and vice versa.
Well, hey, one question I have about specifically that is, I know that you can't drag an effect from the path A to path B.
Correct. You have to copy and paste them. So copy and paste isn't quite done yet. That's the last thing we need to get done. And then the editor will be feature complete. Once the editor is feature complete, provided that we don't find any like big bugs that are mission critical. Now, the keep in mind, the software team that works on the editor and the hardware team that works on the firmware are two completely separate teams.
Right.
The trick is that the software team, the firmware team is quite a bit farther ahead than the software team. And so the firmware team is now currently working on things that just don't impact the editor. So because anytime we add something that also needs to be added to the editor, they both get pushed back.
Oh, gotcha. Gotcha.
So what happens next is once the editor is out and it's feature complete and there's feature parity between it and the firmware, then we hunker down and we make sure that all of the features that we're planning on adding to the hardware also get added to a new version of the software, and then we release both of them at the same time. But we haven't merged those two groups of code in, so we honestly don't know how long it's going to take. In a perfect world, we merge all of the current stuff with the new stuff, and everything goes great, and we go, hey, look, it's here. It could be as much as a couple months. We're not sure.
Okay. So anything we can look forward to, like a Dumbo or...
we do have new models. Not as many models as I'd like, unfortunately. That's certainly coming. A lot of it just has to do with getting the editor up and running.
Okay, yeah. That's fair. It sounds good.
Lots of small improvements. A couple huge big features that we're pretty excited about. It's going to be fun.
Awesome.
Well, I have a question about the editor.
Yeah.
I'm a programmer, so I was wondering if you happen to know what language do they use to write that in?
I don't know. I'm not a programmer. I know the UI engine is programming Qt. It's using Qt engine. That you basically know everything I know now.
I've written software to control other devices before, and playing with that kind of stuff is just really fun to do. So I was just wondering.
So, well, it's been a real pleasure having everybody here. Anybody else have any questions, comments? Whip, you got anything, or you just enjoying?
Yeah, I've been enjoying hearing everybody. The one thing I'm wondering about, I have been using my Helix with some Bose bins, and I've had nothing but trouble trying to get it to sound right. It's just so bottomy and so boomy. Like, I know everybody's talking about rolling back like 110 and that kind of stuff, and I tried doing that kind of thing, but it was just boomy as hell. So I thought I'd try. I've got a supersonic, an old Fender supersonic, and I tried to do the four wire on it, and I couldn't get it to work at all. So I just stuck it in the front of the supersonic, and I, to my amazement, I didn't have to change EQ, didn't have to do anything. It just wailed like the Dickens, and I just love it, just the way it is. Like that, I don't know why it's working. It shouldn't.
Yeah, the listening environment and what you actually monitor modeling through is it cannot be overstressed. It's and especially if you're a gigging musician, if you're tweaking tones on headphones and then expect to go to the gig and you're playing through something else, especially if it's hooked up in a completely different way, like you're going direct in the studio and then suddenly you're going to four cable method live, it's going to sound radically different. And it also, the volume at which you're monitoring is really important too. So if at all possible, when you're in the studio, you want to be you using the same gear that you plan on using live, and you want to be tweaking at the volume you expect to be playing live too. And when it comes to headphones, though, especially, I'm not familiar with those particular Bose cans, but I know a lot of, especially modern headphones, do a lot of bass boost, to compensate for a lot of the lack of energy that you get from those transducers.
This wasn't headphones though. Headphones. It's the sticks like the
PA system.
Yeah.
Were you using two subs or one sub?
A B2. One sub B2. Yeah. Yeah. You're right. I guess so.
Every playback system is going to sound radically different. That's unfortunately what you can do is the global EQ in there is really good at compensating for that sort of stuff. So
now let me put that on screen. I really love the editor version of the global EQ. It actually made me understand it.
What this is really designed to do is it's not designed to be a crutch. It's designed to compensate for the playback system and or listening environment.
Right.
So if the playback system is extremely, say boomy or there's a lot of low end, you can compensate for that in the global EQ, at which point that will affect all of your presets because that's being applied to the entire machine.
Right. But does it make sense, though? Like, I went into a Fender Supersonic straight in without changing. Like, I actually bypassed all of my global EQ and just started using presets that were boomy and stuff before that were not boomy, and they were just kicking ass. They were just doing...
It's not surprising at all. It just comes down to... I have a very, very short story. I had a pair of Mackie HR-824s for the longest time. Even though I have a pair of Atom P22As, which are considerably more expensive, I kept going back to the Mackies because I knew them, intimately. And and then one of them died, and you just can't get them anymore. So did some research, and everybody said, "Yeah, go get the Mark IIs. They sound exactly, they're going to sound as close to the Mark Ones as possible." So then I found a pair of Mark Ones or Mark IIs, got them in there, and they sounded nothing like my Mark Ones at all. And it was just because I was so used to the original Mackies, and so I ended up having to track down a used pair on eBay. And then when I got them back in the studio, I'm like, well, they're still not quite right because they were about 2 or 3 years newer, and they're using different parts and that kind of stuff. So, a lot of it has to do with what you're used to as well. So if you're in the studio and you're switching between 2 or 3 different pairs of speakers, you'll get used to a pair, and you're like, "Oh wow, these actually are sounding pretty good." And you'll switch to a different pair, and like, "Wow, that sounds terrible." But then 15 minutes later, you'll get used to the way they sound. You'll go back to the first pair, and now they'll sound terrible. So, unfortunately, there are a lot of studio monitors say that they're flat, and they're just not. Now the Bose speakers aren't flat at all. They're PA systems. So a lot of like PA speakers aren't true FRFR. A true FRFR speaker is effectively a studio monitor, just louder and burlier for taking on the road, which is the ultimate goal. But your traditional PA speaker is going to have a very, very different frequency response from flat. And even if you were to compare, 8 pairs of $20,000 studio monitors, all of which advertise that they're perfectly flat, they'll still sound radically different from one another. So, the playback system is just it's absolutely mission critical.
Cool. Yeah, I totally concur. And so Whip, as you can see, this global EQ, at least in the editor, you can take and if it's a little boomy, you can take and raise this up and take the. Hang on. Let's see. Takes the bass right out of it. Hang on. So you can, sounds like a megaphone.
And you can, oops, bring it back.
I'm going to sign off, guys. I'll see you next time. Next week again, same time.
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, thanks for putting up with me. I'll try to be a little bit more less talkative next time.
No. We're glad to help. Hopefully you gained something.
Yeah. Thanks, Audacity Works. I appreciate your input.
No problem.
All right. How do you lock out of this thing? Okay. Oh, here we go. All right. Thank you.
Okay. See you later. Thanks for being here. So, just really good information this week, and so glad everybody could be here. Hold on, let me switch out of that. So Whip, the global EQ can go in there if you're needing, you like the tone, but you need to just pull something out, you can go right in there and turn it on and take it right out. So how you doing, Raspberry?
I'm good, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you great.
All right, cool. I had myself muted so you guys wouldn't have to hear me fooling around.
That's a pretty guitar. So, well, guys.
Yeah, I'm not connected to anything, so.
So, do you have any questions while we have Eric?
It's awesome.
Nothing you can answer.
It's awesome to have you here.
Yeah, it was very nice. Thanks, Eric, for being here.
All right. Thanks for all you do. I got to go home and do my taxes. So.
Yeah. Well, it's about time to wrap it up. It's about time we're going to wrap it up. And thank you, everybody, for being here. Next week, we'll do it again. And we might have impromptu, you know, I sometimes have these sort of just, hey, I'm going to go ahead and do one for our UK brethren. So thank you guys. Thank you, everybody.
See ya.
Have a nice night.
Take care.